either way, Earl.
Okay.
Okay. Yep. All right, are we ready to go? Say it again.
There's your big stick if you're ready.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Wednesday, May 18th, 2016, DRCOG Board of Directors meeting. I'd like to call us to order and begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Connie, will you do the roll?
Eva Henry? Eva Henry? Bill Holland?
Yeah, we're talking about the Pledge of Allegiance.
Bill Holland?
Here.
Elise Jones?
Here.
David Beacom?
Here.
Tim Mock?
Here.
Chrissy Fanganello? Anthony Graves?
Here.
Robin Kneach? Kevin Flynn? Roger Partridge?
Here.
Gail Watson? Don Rozier?
Present.
Bob Pfeiffer?
Here.
Bob Roth?
Here.
Larry Vittem?
Here.
David Spellman? Aaron Brockett?
Here.
Ann Justin?
Here.
Lynn Baca? Rex Bell? George Teal?
Here.
Doris Trular?
Here.
Ron Engels? Catherine Hyder? Laura Chrisman?
Here.
Richard Champion?
Here.
Rick Teeter?
Here.
Debbie Nasta? Carl Randolph? Steve Conklin?
Here.
Joe Jefferson?
Here.
Jeff Deacon?
Here.
Daniel Dick?
Present.
Lisa Jones? Laura Brown? Lynette Kelsey?
Here.
Scott Norquist? Storm Glore? Sarah Shakaris Graves? Casey Brown?
Here.
Ron Rakowski? TJ Gordon? Mike Hillman, Brad Weasley, Stephanie Walton, Shakti,
here.
Jerry Bean, Phil Cernanek,
present.
Jackie Millay,
here.
John Peck,
here.
Ashley Stolzman,
here.
Connie Sullivan,
here.
Colleen Whitlow,
here.
Deborah Jerome, Sean Forey, Chris Larson, Kyle Mullica, Jordan Sowers, John Dyack,
here.
Sally Daigle, Gary Howard, Rita Dozal,
here.
Adam Matkowski,
here.
Herb Acheson,
here.
Joyce J,
here.
Gary Sanford, Deborah Perkins Smith, Bill Van Meter,
here.
And we do have a quorum.
All right. Well, now it's my pleasure to introduce new members and alternates, and tonight's news is all about Lone Tree. I don't believe she's here, but the alternate from Lone Tree is Wynn Shaw. She's not here. And it turns out that the mayor, the member of Lone Tree is now the mayor. So congratulations. It's not a huge surprise. We saw that one coming. But
however, in this room, she only gets to be called director.
That's right. You're immediately demoted back. So I'd like to entertain a motion to approve the agenda. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries. So we'll begin with our first strategic informational briefing. We have with us tonight the Mayor's Deputy Chief of Staff, Evan Dreyer, here to talk about the Smart City Challenge that Denver is a finalist competing for. $50 million, and we're looking forward to hearing all about it.
Thanks, everybody. Good evening. I'm Evan Dreyer. I'm Mayor Hancock's Deputy Chief of Staff. Work with me is Kirk Rabias from Jacobs Engineering, one of our lead consultants on this application. I'm going to walk you through a little bit of a PowerPoint presentation. If you have questions as we go, feel free to interrupt. I will try to be brief, yet comprehensive. We received notice from the U.S. Department of Transportation at the beginning of December, which now seems like a very long time ago, notice of funding opportunity for $40 million from the DOT, $10 million from the Vulcan Foundation, and probably in the neighborhood of $20 million additional dollars from other private sector partners that the U.S. DOT has brought to the table. And really, what they are seeking with this Smart City Challenge is for one city to create a technology-driven, innovation-filled proposal that could be replicated in other cities. But really, how do you use technology, innovation, and new ideas to alleviate congestion, improve mobility, address climate change, and improve safety? How do you accomplish all that? Through the use of technology, reduce congestion, improve mobility, and address communities that are low income, high poverty, and otherwise underserved. That's become a very high priority for Secretary Fox as well. They issued the notice at the beginning of December. They got 78 applications from cities around the country, mostly mid-sized cities. That was one of the qualifications. You had to be somewhere in the range of 250,000 to 650,000 population as of the 2010 census. Seven finalists: Austin, Columbus, Denver, Kansas City, Pittsburgh, Portland, and San Francisco. We were announced at the beginning of March, and we have been working ever since on our phase two, round two application, which is due a week from yesterday. So if we look bleary-eyed or are somewhat incoherent in what we're saying, because we're working around the clock trying to put the finishing touches on it. So May 24th is that deadline. Then we have to go to D.C. on June 8th and 9th to make a two-part oral presentation to the secretary and to the selection team, a 45-minute technical presentation. We get locked in a room with the selection panel for a panel-type Q&A. And then the next day on the 9th, each of the seven mayors makes a 10-minute presentation in public in front of the press to the secretary as well. So then we'll know at the end of June who the single recipient city is. The secretary was in Denver yesterday, and Secretary Fox reiterated the one city approach. They are not going to be spreading peanut butter around here. They are going to pick one recipient city. Makes the competition pretty fierce. Opportunities like this don't come around a lot, as you know, so we're trying to put our best foot forward. We feel that we have the right mix of challenges and opportunities, and the DOT really here is looking for what's the return on their investment going to be, what challenges are we going to, what obstacles are we going to overcome, what barriers are we going to be able to break down, how big and bold can we really be. Like a lot of cities, we're experiencing exponential, and I don't have to tell any of you this, population growth. You all are experiencing it as well. And that is a huge contributor to the traffic congestion that we're experiencing right now. Statewide population increased by over 100,000 last year. Denver proper increased by 18,000 people from the middle of 2014 to the middle of 2015. Our population, if it hasn't already, will exceed 700,000 people this year. That's just phenomenal growth in a fairly short period of time. You all are dealing with this as well. Aging, limited, and very expensive infrastructure. There have to be new solutions, and technology is one of the answers to how are we going to move people, things, and ideas around our region more effectively, particularly if we are going to continue to grow at this population game. We can improve infrastructure all we want, but if we can, all we can afford, if we continue to grow at this pace, those improvements will quickly be absorbed as well. We've got some great opportunities and assets here as well. We've got organizations like this one. We, you know this better than most. We come together and we solve big problems. We absolutely are better when we're together. In many ways, we've already been recognized as a smart city. Panasonic, we just had IBM here helping us with the smart cities approach to homelessness and housing. We've got amazing federal and university research laboratories. We just collaborated with Xerox on a mobility app called Go Denver. It was a smart city effort of theirs that they piloted in Denver and in Los Angeles. So we have a lot going for us, a lot of momentum that we can build off of, and that's part of our pitch to Secretary Fox as well. I mentioned underserved communities a little bit ago, and I just want to touch on this again. One of the Secretary's priorities, and all of our priorities, is how do we serve low-income neighborhoods? How do we serve populations and communities who have not received optimal service? And how do we prevent digital divides from getting even wider in an application process that is so geared towards technology? And that's one of the biggest focuses that we have, is trying to make sure that the underserved areas of Denver, which are primarily on the west side, the north side, and the northeast part of Denver, how do we make sure that those stay connected? Is there anything that we can do to reconnect them as well to their phones? Sorry, couldn't help it. there are three main components to our proposal, and I just want to touch on those quickly. Mobility on demand. We are trying to create I call it more and better mobility options for people. How do we get Lyft and Uber into low-income neighborhoods? How do we work with RTD to increase frequency and improve service? How do we improve the types of services that are available on people's phones? And for folks that are unbanked, unphoned, don't have a credit card, how do we serve them as well? So we're talking about a transit or transportation card. We're talking about a universal payment system that could be accessed via a card or a kiosk or an ATM-like machine in a 7-Eleven or a dollar store. How do you bring mobility right to people's fingertips, right to their doorsteps, right into their neighborhoods? And those are some of the things that are contained within this specific part of the proposal. Transportation electrification. We're working with RTD. They're in the process of updating their entire fleet of hundreds of buses, and we're working with them to see if we can electrify on one of their busiest routes, the 15 on Colfax. Can we buy with them, using some of these grant funds, 10 electric buses? So that entire route is served by electric buses. That route, as you know, cuts all the way across the city. It cuts through some of the most underserved neighborhoods and populations in Denver, and if we can provide a cleaner transit option for them in the form of RT bus service and soon bus rapid transit, that's an amazing step forward for us. We're working closely with Xcel Energy as well. Grid decarbonization is a big part of this. Imagine if you've got an electric car and you are plugging it in to charge it, and the energy that you're charging with comes from the sun and from the wind. Then we really created a green ecosystem around transportation. Intelligent vehicles, this is the super sexy driverless car that we may get to someday. Our proposal doesn't specifically call for driverless cars, but we're trying to make sure that we are ready and prepared, and that we're doing things around connected vehicles, automated vehicles, working with CDOT on their RoadX and managed motorways programs. They've generously agreed to kick in about $14 million of existing and new dollars to support us as well. So we're really grateful for that partnership too. Those three components will all be connected through an enterprise data management ecosystem. Really, I try to think about this in the simplest terms because I'm not an engineer like my friend Kirk is. How do we gather up as much data from so many disparate data sources and make it usable so that the Xeroxes of the world, the RTDs of the world, the U's of the world can use that data on your phone or at your computer, on a tablet or a device, or at one of those sidewalk kiosks? And then how do we keep contributing to that data with new sensors everywhere so that this ecosystem really is a living, breathing, learning thing and becomes more usable, and that we're able to analyze it but make that data usable to people? And that's really the connective tissue to the whole proposal. This is a graphic that attempts to explain that ecosystem. I think it's gotten even more complicated as we refine the proposal. I don't attempt to explain it. We just leave it there for mostly for laughing purposes. The mobility piece.
On that, going at the enterprise data management, you might want to add or consider adding to it one of the things of being reliable so that it ends up being predictable for the users. And the second piece to include with it is some aspects of adaptable or flexible, so that if there are changes in service or changes that occur, that those things can actually appear on the fly. So those would be a couple of things that I would put into the EDM to say, hey, this is really what you want to do, so that the user, being the folks that we're trying to put mobility to their fingertips, so that it's an easy system for them.
Yeah. Just because I didn't say it doesn't mean it's not there. In this case, it absolutely is there. We were just talking earlier today about living in intelligent data sets and trying to do all this with the user in mind. Is there anything you want to add?
Oh, yeah. If I could, so USDOT has also offered to us Amazon Web Services to give us that scalability and redundancy that we're looking for. So they've given us the engine to really support this type of ecosystem. So we're really excited about that. And you hit the nail on the head. That's what we're looking for with this type of solution, is that you really can pull together kind of the brains of a smart city. So
these are some of the partners that we're working with on the mobility option as well, a mix of public and private sector transportation service providers as well. Transportation electrification, we talked a little bit about electric intelligent vehicles as well. The outcomes, and I think the outcomes really for us is, again, to what Phil was saying, is one of the most important parts of this. What will the Department of Transportation get for its $40 million investment? What's that return for them? And so being able to measure the performance of the specific projects is extremely important. We've tried to, I think, just describe a few of them here very generally. Scalability, replicability, and exportability is one of the most important things to them. And this group and this body, I think, is a great demonstration and example of how we can collaborate and scale here at a local and a regional level. And what the DOT is looking for, how can you take some of these specific projects and export it to 40, 50 cities around the country, DOT, local cities. We don't all have the brain power. We certainly don't have the money. And we each have unique challenges and opportunities. But a lot of things are common. And how do we take some of these projects that we're talking about and export them to other cities? Safety. Denver just adopted a Vision Zero program. We're trying to eliminate all fatal and serious bodily injury crashes. Safety is obviously one of the biggest parts of any transportation and mobility system, and is foremost as we're thinking about some of these specific projects as well. Improve mobility, reduce congestion. That's part of the whole point. Improved efficiency when it comes to people and dollars, systems as well. Climate change, reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Transportation sector is a number two contributor to greenhouse gas emissions, and we're obviously very interested in how we can make a dent there. Excel's been a great partner with us, and we look forward to continuing that work, whether we win this grant or not. And then the ladders of opportunity, that's a phrase that both the President and Secretary Fox have used to describe how do you use transportation to knit communities together, to make place, and to use transportation really as an opportunity and, pardon the pun, a vehicle to help connect people to jobs, to education, to affordable housing. And so some of the other work that we're doing in other spaces, Councilwoman Kanisha and I are doing a lot of work on affordable housing and homelessness right now. How do we tie that in as well? And I know many of you are working on those issues too. Those are just some of the private sector partners. One of the most interesting aspects of this grant proposal really is that the way that the DOT has invited private sector partners, including Vulcan, to come to the table with very tangible economic contributions. They're looking at not just how can a recipient city match and leverage the DOT dollars, but how can some of these private sector businesses, which are, you know, used to coming to knocking on a door and saying, hey, we've got a service that we'd like to sell you. Instead, it's the reverse. The DOT has wrestled these groups to the table and into a room to say, all right, if you guys want to play, what are you going to put on the table? And so some of these organizations and businesses are bringing millions of dollars worth of services, and so the stack is that much higher. It may be double what DOT had originally envisioned as well. We've obviously got a lot of local partners here as well, and we're grateful for the support that many of you have provided individually and collectively as well. I think that's primarily a summary. Happy to take questions. I'm not sure how much time we have, but we will stay for as long as you have questions or you kick us out.
Director Holland.
As you know, Evan, Arapahoe County has endorsed this project, and we've sent a letter.
Thank you.
I'm frankly quite excited about the prospects here, because I think as Dr. Cog reflects a wider range of constituents and entities, governmental entities, I think the research and the focus is going to be very, very helpful and collaborative with all cities. So I'm really excited about the program. I think what's key here is that technology is changing so rapidly, compounding every 24 hours in some areas. The challenge is, how are you going to keep ahead of that? And that's, I think that's the engineering challenge that I think is going to be interesting to address. So thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you, and thank you for Arapahoe County support. Appreciate it.
Other questions? Director Shakti.
Who's our big competitor out of the seven?
You know, they're all our big competitors, really. You look at each one of these cities, and they are all unique in their own ways, and they all have challenges that are in some ways different from ours. Obviously, every city is different, and in some ways, they're the same as ours. Pittsburgh is a city where they had not experienced rapid population increase the way we have. In fact, their population almost got cut in half because of economic cycles, other forces. Our population has doubled in the last few decades. There are similarities, there are differences. Austin and Denver are often talked about as sort of the two it cities. Portland has, I think, in a lot of ways, an amazing transportation and mobility network already, but they have incredible highway congestion. Whether or not $40, $50 million in cash, plus what the other partners are bringing to the table, could actually make a dent in some of those cities, that's a question that I think that the DOT will be asking. Austin, similar, lots of innovation, a lot of great ideas and creativity there, but they've got some really significant transportation-related challenges. Will $40 or $50 million make a difference, or will it catalyze change? We feel like we've got a good mix of challenges that can be solved. Our challenges are not so insurmountable that $40 to $50 million would not really, that it would make a difference. It would make a huge difference here. So I think we feel good. Win or lose, we will have a business plan that we'll be able to implement. We'll have to go find the funding for it, but we'll have good projects, we'll have a good program and good systems that we can implement. Might take a little bit longer, but it's a good question. We try not to obsess about that too much. it's like running a political campaign. You can only can control what you can control. And if we have a good plan, that's probably the best that we can do.
There you go. Director Rozier.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Don Rozier, Jefferson County. On your first or second, shouldn't say first slide, it's slide 10, says why Denver and challenges. Mm-hmm. One of them was aging, limited, and expensive infrastructure. I did not see you address how technology was going to help that, or this application, how that was going to be addressed. Also, when you look at rapid population growth and traffic congestion, one of the examples you gave is on one of the busiest bus lines is a swap out of buses. To me, that's not changing congestion, that's just swapping one use for another use. So I was just curious as far as that traffic congestion. And then underserved communities, speaking for Jefferson County, you know, when you mentioned it, it was more of an economic underserved community. In Jefferson County, it doesn't matter your economic kind of status. We have entire communities that are not served at all because of cutbacks from RTD and others that are really affecting our aging population. So you made that connection just to that economic profile, but I just wanted to throw out that it spans all economic profiles.
Yeah, I think you make very good points. Your last point's absolutely correct. I think one of the things that we're realizing with this application and the process around gathering up these ideas is this is not a silver bullet like a lot of the work that you all deal with. The change that we're trying to make is incremental, and this can catalyze a lot of things, but it will not solve a lot of the problems. So, and just two of the first two things that you mentioned as well. I think the aging, limited, and very expensive infrastructure is really meant to make the point that we need new solutions other than trying to add lanes and make the typical kinds of traditional infrastructure improvements that will continue to be important. But just as an example, we maybe about 8 years ago, we added one lane to Federal Boulevard for 1 mile, and it cost $30 million. For those of you that have done those big interchange projects, big improvement projects, you know the cost of infrastructure. It's extremely expensive, and the funding formulas, the financial models that we have are not going to allow us to keep pace with that. On the 15 on Colfax, we're trying to answer a number of required deliverables. One of them is climate. If we can electrify and clean up the kind of transit that is offered right now, that is a positive in the eyes of the DOT. But point well taken.
So we're going to need to move along. I guess Jennifer would like to make a comment.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention to you, Evan, that we provided a letter of support when you first submitted your application, and we'll be providing another one now that you're in the top seven.
Great. Thank you. And thank you to both of you for participating yesterday. Yeah, absolutely. It was great. We had about 20 or 25 people around the table with Secretary Fox yesterday, and it was a very productive, it was only an hour, but it was a really good conversation where we got to make our pitch directly to the Secretary.
Thanks to both of you for coming tonight, sharing with us. We look forward to celebrating the victory in June and getting regular updates after that. So thanks again.
Thanks all.
All right, moving on to my report. I'll be brief. I did want to highlight a couple things. One is thanks to all that who were able to make it to the annual awards dinner. I think it was a smashing success by any metric. I wish all of you could have been there. You missed out on a really exciting night if you weren't there. It was a great venue. We had a wonderful MC in the form of Amelia Earhart. And if you didn't hear, Jack Hilbert won the John B. Christensen Award, and he was surprised, and that was fun as well. So thanks for those of you who can make it. Make sure and put it on your calendars for next year. The board survey. Some of you have received five or six notices now, and perhaps even a hassle call from one of the board officers. We're really trying to get as many people as possible on the board to fill out the survey. It's really asking, how do we work together as a board? So if there's anybody here tonight that is still having problems and doesn't recall seeing the survey yet, we'll send it yet again. Feel free to raise your hand. Connie will do it on the spot. All right, I can do it.
First thing in the morning.
All right, well, thanks. We will leave it open till May 23rd, so you have a few more days to get those in. Your input is very much valued, and we know who you are if you don't respond. And because surveys are us, this survey is going to end early next week, and then you will have the opportunity to provide your input on another survey, which is the annual personnel evaluation for our illustrious executive director. So be looking forward to that email survey. Please fill that one out as well. That will be coming Tuesday. Is that right? Okay. And the last thing I wanted to mention is several of us got to participate in the Live Ride Share conference that happened at the convention center yesterday. I gave welcoming remarks along with Mayor Hancock. Bob Roth spoke on a panel, and Jayla also did a panel. And it was all about how we can use the emerging shared use mobility that's sweeping the nation. How can we use that, harness that, for the betterment of everybody in our communities? And I have to say, it was very exciting. There were national leaders on this, as well as a whole lot of local stakeholders there. It's the kind of stuff that I think Dr. Cog needs to be working on. And it's really, Director Rozier's point, it's basically helping get mobility to places that for example, don't have transit now. How do we make everybody a winner when it comes to mobility? How do we get it to low-income communities? How do we better serve our elderly population using these shared-use mobility options? So it's really exciting stuff, and we'll probably look for opportunities to bring that to the Dr. Cog table more in future discussions. And I think that's it from me. So let me turn it over to Jennifer.
Okay, thank you very much. I want to call your attention to a couple of handouts at the table. First is this little postcard. This is about the annual board workshop. You'll recall last year you decided to have it in the end of summer so that we could start planning the budget and strategic initiatives for the coming year sooner than later. So this is August 5th and 6th. Registration is open. The directions for registering are on the back of the card, so please put that on your calendar and please go online and register. The other document that I'd like to call your attention to is the announcement for Bike to Work Day. Bike to Work Day is coming up on June 22nd. Dr. Cog actually has the biggest or second largest Bike to Work Day in the country. We shoot for first every year. Let's make this year be it. There's information on how to register on this flyer. And you might have noticed when you came in there were some t-shirts and sign-up sheets out in the lobby. That is for board members to sign up and get a t-shirt. So if you haven't done that already, be sure that you sign up on your way out. Steve Erickson, who's standing right back there by the door, will be there to help you out if you need any help with that.
Do we have to promise to bike?
Well,
I think you're supposed to say yes.
It would be really nice if you did. But yeah, it'd be great if you biked to work. And hopefully, unlike last year, you won't be canoeing home.
I heard that Steve was actually going to be pedaling around the metro area, just validating that folks are biking to work.
That could be. okay, so now I will call your attention to Attachment B, the Executive Director's Monthly Report. As I've told you before, this is still a work in progress, although I think we're getting really close to finalizing this and having performance measures and targets for everything that's in this report. So since it is still a work in progress, I'm just going to hit some of the highlights starting on page 5 and make note that Dr. Cog's Boomer Bond, which is this opportunity to help communities be more age-friendly, has won the National Association of Area Agencies on Aging Innovation Award. It's a really big deal for us. As I've told you before about Boomer Bond, there's a lot of interest in this. We have about a dozen communities now that are interested. They're either in some phase or another with implementing the Boomer Bond or getting ready to implement the Boomer Bond or having expressed interest to staff that this is something we want to do. As soon as you've got time for us, put us on your list. So really exciting that this is going as well as it has and that we're receiving now national recognition for this program. Another award that we were part of, Cone, is our marketing group for our Way to Go program, and they recently won the Business Marketing Association's award for our Dr. Cog's Way to Go-tober campaign. And they didn't only win the award for the materials in the campaign, but they won the award for the results of the campaign. We had really good participation, so way to go, Steve and his staff on that one too. And Elise has already pointed out that Jack Hilbert, former Douglas County Commissioner, won Dr. Cog's JVC Award at the dinner last month. I'm going to skip on over to page 7 and point out that we have added some new partners for our Accountable Health Communities grant. We've added now Centura Health Systems and Denver Health. That application is due next week, actually. We're keeping our fingers crossed. What?
It's submitted today.
Oh, it was submitted today. Way to go. I'd also point out that a couple of weeks ago I was in Phoenix with our Intermountain peers. All the MPOs and the TMAs in the Intermountain West got together to talk about things like activity-based modeling, the work that Dr. Cog and the Maricopa Association of Governments are doing around big data and how we're using that, our different visualization tools, et cetera. On page 8, I'll note that we have been meeting a lot with FHWA and FTA and CDOT for the quadrennial certification of the MPO. They come in every 4 years to be sure that we're following the rules, that We're following all federal guidance. They're sharing with us best practices that they've learned about from other places. So you will actually be getting a report from the feds on the certification in another couple of months. I think I mentioned, I'm not sure, but I think that I've mentioned before that we have a new partnership with AM 1430 and to record a show for that's broadcast every Saturday. And I got to tell you, it's a really good show. Our interviewers on the show are Dr. John Torres. He is the health reporter for 9 News. And Murphy Houston, who's been a Denver area radio staple for like 40 years. And so we do 10 minutes to talk about things related to aging. We've talked about just an overview of DRCOG and an overview of the AAA. We just finished up a 3-part series on caregiving, what caregiving is all about, how caregivers should take care of themselves, where caregivers can find resources. We're having another couple of tapings that are coming up next week to talk about housing. So that's the first 10 minutes. The other 20 minutes of the show are Dr. John Torres and Murphy Houston talking about other issues related to health and wellness. And they are really good. You can find the shows as they're being broadcast. You can find the shows on the DRCOG website. I'd really encourage you to take a listen to those. We have entered our first veteran in the Veterans Directed program in April. This is brand new to us. The feds have kind of figured out that the AAAs really have a lot of great knowledge and a lot of experience in helping people find the resources they need. So we now have a contract or an agreement with the Veterans Administration to provide some of our case management type services to veterans. Let's see, what else should I will point out too on page 9, we're still having a little bit of a scheduling issue meeting with some of our board members. Flo Rotano and myself are trying to meet with all the board members in one-on-one meetings. This past April we were only able to meet with 2, but I think that together we've already met with 6, maybe 7 this month. So you'll see a lot of improvement in that chart in the next report. Page 11, we talk about our success at the Capitol. The session is over. This report was the end of April, so you'll again see some more data on this chart next month. But of the 5 bills that came to some sort of conclusion that you took a position on during the session, the legislature took the position that you hoped that they would. So we've had a lot of success so far at the legislature. So that wraps it up for my monthly report, unless there are any questions of board members.
Any questions for Jennifer? All righty. Thanks so much. I'd now like to open it up for public comment for anybody in the audience that would like to come speak to us for 3 minutes on an item that's not currently pending before us. Welcome. Please introduce yourself for the record.
Sure. My name is Luke Miller, and I work for the Apartment Association of Metro Denver. I wanted to just quickly address the council and remind you again of our Colorado Housing Financial Assistance Guide. The Apartment Association of Metro Denver represents over 2,000 owners, managers, and vendors that serve the multifamily industry. And we recognize that there's a need for affordable housing. That's why we partner with a number of organizations to address the issue and focus on best practices moving forward. However, we also realize that there's a gap. There's also a gap between services needed and services available. This led us to create this guide. This guide, it's also printed in Spanish on the back. It represents, it has over 100 places where residents can go for assistance with utility payments, rent, moving assistance, down payment assistance, or security deposits. Really, this guide was the result of us hearing from residents, hearing from elected officials that we needed this comprehensive guide in one place where people could go. So by partnering with CHAFA, the Colorado Division of Housing, we're hoping this guide can be circulated far and wide. So that's why I'm here today, getting the word out. So I have a few copies here with me tonight, but it's also available for download on our website. But if anyone's interested, I'm happy to pass them out. But I look forward to working with you in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other takers for public comment? Seeing none, we'll close the public comment period.
I'd take a copy as well.
And with that, we'll move on to our consent agenda. Jackie wants one, and Joyce, I think. Oh. All right, we might have more hands up than we have books. We could share. All right, I'm going to keep running the meeting, though. So I consider a motion to approve the consent agenda, if someone's so inclined.
I so move.
We have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We will now move on to the meat of our agenda, which is a discussion of the hard work that we've done to date on Metro Vision 2040 outcomes and objectives. I think Brad's going to give us an overview.
Thank you, Madam Chair. No real formal presentation tonight. Just a quick kind of reminder of what's happened over the past few months. This is attachment G in your packet, I believe page 69 in the PDF. As noted in the memo, tonight's action really kind of builds on some work that the board did back in January when you approved a set of 5 overarching themes and 14 outcomes to be included in the revised Metro Vision plan. Since that time, you've continued your work of reviewing the draft plan through the lens of DRCOG's strategic framework. NVIC initiated the review of the regional objectives in February, and then that review transitioned over to the work session format in March, continuing through May. So tonight, staff is requesting approval of the draft regional objectives, regional objective narratives, and supporting objectives shown in Attachment 1. Attachment 1 also includes the previously adopted overarching themes as well as outcomes and narratives that this body adopted back in January, and those are shown in the gray boxes just to kind of give you the full context. Those objectives shown in Attachment 1 come with sort of a blended recommendation or endorsement, if you will. In February, NVIC recommended to the board any objective associated with outcomes 1, 2, and 3, and then as I mentioned, when the work session started in March, they picked up that work, and all objectives, including objective narratives, come through the work session with at least an initial endorsement. So that's really it for staff's presentation.
Great. Thanks so much. Well, and let me just add my 2 cents worth to thank all of the folks who have been dutifully attending MVIC meetings and then the board work sessions to really go through this in detail and work hard on it. We appreciate that hard work. So let me open it up for any questions. We can go through this one by one if need be, but I don't know if we do. So I'll open it up for questions and see how many we have. I don't see that we have very many. Director Stolzman.
I was just going to say I could make a motion.
Well, seeing no questions, I think that'd be appropriate.
I move to approve the Metro Vision 2040 plan drafts, regional objective narratives, and supporting objectives.
So, further discussion. Director Partridge.
You know, all the way throughout, I think I made the comments that certainly as we understand, this is a non-regulatory document, and that it is a vision plan. And I made a comment, certainly a couple words that I think really bring attention to it, that are pushing this to be policy, regulatory, and not a guiding document. And those words are will and shall. So I would just make the comment, I'm fine to move along for the point of discussion, but I think we have to really consider that we have those words removed. I think there has been time and MPIC at a few times, and I think it has been by staff that's been removed. But I'd request that we remove anywhere it says will, shall, that it is a directive, a regulatory statement, a policy statement. That is not our place in Metro Vision. So I'll just make that comment, but I'm certainly in favor of moving this forward for further discussion.
Comments? Director Millay.
And I think for the benefit of the board, the directors that have not been participating in the work sessions, one of the things that we have asked staff to do is kind of write a preamble to this document, which I think will hopefully clarify some of the very good issues raised by Commissioner Director Partridge. And that talks about what this document is and it is not, and it is a vision plan, and it is something that communities can look to as a resource. And I think your comments are very important that we keep in mind that this is not a regulatory document, and hopefully that when we see the preamble language, that will be addressed.
And if I might just insert and add on to that comment, this is our vision for the region. It's aspirational. We don't have regulatory authority over any jurisdictions. We come together and voluntarily aspire to these good things for our region. And we also recognize that DRCOG is not the only player in achieving these outcomes for the region, that we're all in this together, local governments doing what they're able and willing to do, and our many stakeholders in the nonprofit and business sector joining with us. So in that spirit, I think it's helpful for everybody to understand what this document does. So, additional comments? All right. Then I think we're ready to vote. We have a motion on the table. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? The motion carries unanimously. Wow. This could be a very efficient meeting. Oh, I don't want to jinx us. Well, I just think... I don't want to stir it up.
You got it done. Let's move on.
I was going to almost say that maybe I was wrong about the work sessions not solving our Groundhog Day problem, and I don't want to jinx us, but so far so good. And this is case in point, so I'm willing to be
careful
wrong
with talking beyond the sale.
Okay, and with that, we'll move on to the next action item, which is the ballot initiatives that we heard about at our last work session. I think Rich Marr is going to give us an update.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and I'll do what I can to keep things rolling along, too. So speaking of work sessions, at the May 4th work session, the group had heard presentations from two expected ballot initiatives that mainly affecting transport, one from the Colorado Contractors on transportation funding and one from Building a Better Colorado, or now it's called Colorado Priorities, on a Tabor timeout, and asked to put these on the agenda for today for board consideration of positions. I will add that you don't, just for a point of information, you don't need to feel pressured to take a position tonight. You certainly can if you're feel like you're at that point, but for two reasons. One is the Colorado Contractors Initiative is not going to go forward, so we can save time on that tonight. They made a decision today, or announced it anyway today, that they're going to, at least for the time being, wait till 2018 to move forward. As far as the other one and most of these initiatives, they're just now starting to gather signatures, and we have someone here who's asked to speak a little bit about it. They just kicked off their signatures when I think they've got till like the first week of August to turn those signatures in. Secretary of State will probably, if they have enough, to get on the ballot by the end of August. So they probably won't really start their campaign in full until shortly thereafter, like September. But just to give you a brief little bit of what the time frame is overall on those, and then I'll step back and you can talk about Colorado Priorities.
Thank you for that update, Rich. And we do have a member from the Colorado Priorities campaign here to give us a brief update.
Yep. Hi, my name is Jake Martin. I'm the campaign manager on the Colorado Priorities campaign.
First, I want to thank you for letting us speak 2 weeks ago when Maria was here giving a presentation, and thanks for giving me a few minutes tonight. I just want to give you an update on where we are in the campaign. Shortly after the presentation a couple weeks ago, we pulled petitions on Initiative 117. So this is the initiative that would allow the state to retain excess revenue for 10 years. And this is similar to measures that have been passed by cities, counties, school districts, special districts throughout the state. For the governments in the room, it's at least 35 of you have passed measures similar to this, while another dozen of you have passed measures that are close to this, that have, I'm going to use the bad word, I'm going to use debrucing, but you've passed measures that are temporarily do that or do that to part of your government's budget. This measure also has an allocation of those funds, so anything above the current TABOR spending limit, at least 35% of that would be allocated toward transportation, and that would follow the second stream HUTF spending. So 18% to cities, 22% to counties, and then 60% to the state. And then at least 35% would go toward education. The remaining money would only be allowed to be used for mental health services and senior services. And again, this measure would last for 10 years. As a quick update on the campaign, since we pulled petitions last weekend, we kicked off the campaign in 20 cities throughout the state. We started petition collection. We had 220 volunteers. We put 1,000 petition packets out there. So we're starting our signature gathering. We have until August 8th, as Rich said, we have to get 98,492 signatures. So we're hoping to get 160,000 to make sure we have that cushion to be sure we're on the ballot. We'd love to have your support. You have a critical voice in the front range, and we'd love to have your support. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Any questions for Mr. Martin?
Well, thank you.
Thank you. We appreciate you coming here tonight. Okay. Director Rakowski.
Being old and senile, I would ask that you review what positions we've taken in the last 5 years, and maybe that's a question for Rich, on pros and cons on any ballot measures.
Well, the ones that I remember most clearly are referendum C and D.
I remember that one.
I don't know what else.
And I'm getting old and senile too, so. Those might have been the last ones, actually, because there hasn't really, to my recollection, been much of any that were, you know, more directly related to, say, a Dr. Cog.
And the reason I asked the question is for younger, brighter board members that may be facing this issue and wonder, you know, how often do we do this and what have we done it in the past? And I don't mean to be pejorative or positive either way on this particular measure. I mean, I have my personal feelings, but I'd rather see the discussion go forward.
Yeah, and we do typically bring these before the board if they more or less directly impact the region or a Dr. Cog program.
Director Brockett.
And can you clarify what position Dr. Cog took on those two initiatives?
Great. In support.
Thank you.
We supported both of them.
Madam Chair, is this on? Madam Chair, my name is Richard Champion. I have a question. Is this the appropriate time to talk about Amendment 69 to the Colorado Constitution?
Well, I can just mention if the board wants to take that up, I think we can do it. Obviously you can make that decision. We didn't prepare to talk about it tonight, but and for those of you in the room, that is the one initiative that is in fact already on the ballot, and that's the one that would change the health care system in Colorado. That one's already turned in its signatures and been certified for the ballot.
Right, that's the tax of $25 billion. Okay.
So Director Partridge wants to speak. If folks want to take that measure up for discussion, I would suggest maybe that we get a briefing on it before we attempt to take a position. So after Director Partridge speaks, maybe folks can give us an indication if that's something that they think Dr. Cog should consider.
comment certainly from about Douglas County specifically 69, but I think it applies to Dr. Cog staff. So we looked at this. Certainly anybody and everybody will be affected by this. So we looked at it for Douglas County. It would be a $5.9 million increase to the Douglas County government and a $3 million increase to our employees. So I suggest everybody look at this for your own jurisdiction, but I don't think it might be a wise thing for Dr. Cog to look at, see how it would affect Dr. Cog. So I certainly see no doubt we have for each jurisdiction has an issue, but we as Dr. Cog, I think it would be an impact on us. But again, $5.9 million to Douglas, to the government or the taxpayers, and $3 million to the employees.
So could we see a show of hands or for folks that would like the Dr. Cog board to be briefed on Measure 69? Okay, so it sounds like enough. So we would schedule that for maybe an upcoming work session and then the subsequent board. No?
I'm teasing.
Yes, Director Malley.
Not everything has to go to the work session. I think we could have a briefing at the board meeting and just to think about that. The work sessions are heavily loaded with MetroVision, so.
Director Malley makes a good point. So why don't we'll look at schedules and see. We also probably have some flexibility on timing for that. So
thank you.
If I might take us back to the issue that's before us right now, which is the Colorado priorities measure and whether or not we want to take a stance on that tonight. I guess I have a question for staff. As I understand it, given the actions or the lack thereof in the state legislature, is this the only opportunity to increase the funding available for transportation that we currently have before us?
Yes, that's my understanding. Yep.
Okay.
Can we give some more detail on that?
I'm sorry. Director Edge.
Can we get a little bit more detail on exact details? I know we had a briefing at the last meeting, but with some of the changes that have taken place with what the legislature more didn't do than they did do, which was darn little.
Sure. You mean to talk about what the legislature? I could give part of what I was going to give in my legislative wrap-up. But
no, I'm just talking about on this particular issue. Can we get a little bit more detail from the staff position on this before we take a position as a board?
Well, if you want to wait, if you don't want to take a position, if you don't feel you have enough information to take a position tonight, we could talk about what additional information you would like and come back. We could do that.
That's fine with me. Whatever the majority of the board would like.
Sure.
I'm not comfortable making a decision on that sitting here right now.
Yeah. And I might ask, Jake, do you know, or are there some numbers, estimates of if this passed, how much money would be retained?
So I believe the only estimates go through the next fiscal year, and I believe that's $256 million. Not next year, but the following year.
Because that's basically like what was the estimate of what the Tabor rebates would have been.
Correct.
Without it. So there'd be about 250, and I think those are projected to grow several years down from that point on. So for next year, it would be $250 million and at least 35% of that for transportation.
87.5.
Thank you.
Other comments, questions from the board? So the question before us is, do we want to take a position on that tonight? I mean, I can take off my board a chair hat and say, in terms of I think where we are, I do think that this is our only opportunity for new transportation funds coming down the pike right now, given what didn't happen at the legislature, given that there's not any other ballot measures related to transportation that seem to be going to the ballot, that are going to the ballot, nothing is being considered, that there is a direct nexus with Dr. Cog's transportation work. So I would be comfortable moving forward tonight if others are interested as well, but pleasure of the board. Director Roth and then Director Christman.
I would make a motion that we take a position of support this evening.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Director Christman.
I guess I'm discussion.
Yes. Yes, you are.
Since I
generally take this type of thing back to council. And this is last time when Maria said, I'm too short. That's as far as it'll go. Maria said that it might get pulled if the hospital fee didn't go through the, you know, the exemption didn't go through. So clearly that must not have happened.
Right.
And thus I did not discuss it at council. So if we vote tonight, I would be forced to abstain. I prefer to talk to them about it and recommend it to council and then come back. But okay. I may be the only one who's subject to that.
I see Director Beacom, then Director Pfeiffer, then Director Holland, and then Director Teal.
My only concern would be that while initially I think that it's worth supporting, I also would like to know that we can change our mind as things develop along the road, more information is gained on the matter. So what my question is, are we stuck with supporting it continuously, or can we change our mind as we go along?
Jennifer.
I'm going to assume that if you take a position of support, that will be used by the campaign as a way to get others to support. So if you're going to support it now, I would think that they would prefer that you maintain that support. So if you want to wait, that's an option too. As you heard earlier, we're into August before it kind of the time to take a position starts to close down.
Thank you for answering my question.
I think Director Pfeiffer was up next.
So personally, I would obviously support this, but the reservation I have from my council is we're strategizing on transportation language for our own community. So another tax question for us to support streets and roads. So I would have to also abstain from this because my council's strategizing. This is just another tax question. With all of them hitting the ballot at the same time, I think it might create some confusion by our base. So
if I could make just one comment on for your board strategizing. This is not an actual tax question. This is simply it's asking the voters if we can retain all the revenue. So it's a distinction.
No, I get that, but as a typical voter may not look at it the way that you just explained it. So we would like to understand the strategy of how everything on that ballot would look and what message is being set at state, county, city levels regarding taxes.
Director Holland, then Director Teal, then Director Millay, then Director Solzen.
While I'm personally supportive of this proposal, I like others in the room, I'm going to have to sustain from voting until I get a full commitment from my fellow commissioners.
Director Teal.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Castle Rock is actually a community that has sustained the Taxpayer Bill of Rights within our own community. Therefore, I do have a knee-jerk reaction to oppose this motion. But I would ask that we oppose it just because I'm just hearing too much indecision among the board. We're hearing over and over again directors explaining that they'd really like to bounce this off their councils, perhaps the county commissions. And so, I mean, I don't feel like we have an informed consent at the moment among the entire board. So I would like to speak against the motion, not so much from the perspective of my community, but just from what I'm hearing around the table. I think we can put this off another month, get a little better consult back with the home boards, the home committees, home councils, and probably get a better decision in a month.
Thank you. Director Millay.
I think we need to keep in mind what this initiative is actually doing, and I appreciate the fact that the town of Castle Rock chose to not use the bad language, de-Bruce, but you are allowed to make that choice. And what we're doing with this initiative, or what they're proposing to do with this initiative, is allow the voters to make that same choice. And denying the voters the opportunity to make a choice, in my mind, what that is wrong. That's not for us to decide. If the voters want to put this on, this is an opportunity to hear their voice and to listen to what the voters of this state want to do with transportation and education funding. And frankly, please tell us how short we are for funding on transportation in the metro region alone. Like, give me a ballpark number, guys.
$500 million.
Okay, so we're going to get $87.5 million from this. We just heard from our friends in Denver that it was $30 million for 1 mile extension of a road. I mean, where are we going to be funding these transportation projects? I want to hear from the voters in this state about whether or not they're willing to allow us to keep money to fund education and transportation, two things that every single one of at this table continue to say we are sorely underfunded and we need the money for. So I am very supportive of Dr. Cog supporting this initiative and going out to the voters and allowing them to make a choice. So I appreciate that people need to go back and talk to their councils, but to me, you have to ask your council if you're going to allow the community to make a choice. Doesn't pass the smell test.
All right, Director Stolzman.
Thank you very much. I really appreciated the way Director Rakowski sort of laid out this discussion in the beginning, sort of saying why would we want to support something or why would we want to oppose something and when have we done it in the past. I find that line of thought really interesting. We talked about this at our city council last night in Louisville, and we had one council member bring up several reasons why our council might want to support or oppose something. So some of those that I'll bring up here I think apply to this. So if there's a direct fiscal impact to the organization, we might want to take a position on it. If there's a regulatory interest from our council, we might want to. And I think some of these apply to our board here as Dr. Cog. If we think there's constituent support and we want to represent that, if there's something that we really think we need to make a point on and we want the media attention that we'd like to go out and make a point. And if we think that there would be a better effort if there was regional and sub-regional support, and so if we worked collaboratively together by supporting it, those would be reasons why we thought we might want to support something and use, you know, our identity or brand to get behind that. So in this case, the city of Louisville, we talked about it and thought that we could support this tonight, and I understand that some of you maybe haven't had those discussions yet. But I could vote on it tonight. I also understand the need for more information. So for those of you who said you need to wait, I'm comfortable waiting till we have more information. It's not like the timetable on this is super critical. But I do think from a Dr. Cog perspective, there is a direct fiscal impact. We sit around this table a lot of the time talking about how we need more transportation dollars. So I could see why Dr. Cog would want to support this and why as directors for Dr. Cog, we would want to support this.
Thanks. Director Rakowski.
Given the request for additional information, given the fact that some people want to talk to their councils, like my dear neighbor to the north at Cherry Hills, and also given where the calendar is in this whole process, I would propose an intervening superseding motion to postpone to the next board meeting.
All right, anyone want to speak to the, what did you call it, an inter?
Superseding. Motion.
As opposed to a substitute or?
Yeah, it's really super. I don't want to take your motion off the table, but I think this supersedes it, and it would basically extend your motion to the next board meeting. Keeps it alive.
Okay. Director Shenanick.
Yes, if you wanted to put a date on that, it's actually June 15th. If we have that, which is the, or is it, isn't that the second?
I would concur to that addition.
Or third Wednesday, excuse me, in June, which would be the scheduled date for the next board meeting. And I would support the delay of consideration and might even support if we got to that point and wanted to go a little bit further. I'm not sure it's going to impact the campaign around this necessarily. But it allows many of us to take it back because it is, and you know, we have some of the same issues as Arvada has that Director Pfeiffer mentioned. So there's a number of positions that
are complicating this as far as a consideration, and would say it allows us, I think, to be a little more orderly.
Thank you. Director Roth.
I will point out that on June 15th, there are several of us that will not be here due to the Accelerate Colorado trip to D.C. I think there's probably at least a half a dozen of us that won't be here.
Do you want to say that out loud?
Yeah.
Oh.
We as elected members can't be here.
You got to speak into your mic.
Remember, we have alternates.
So any other comments on the timing? Okay. Oh, sorry. Director Teal.
Yeah, I'll speak in favor of the substitute motion, superseding motion, to go ahead and delay by the month.
Well, I'll speak to the motion. I want to respect folks that want more time to consider this. My preference would be to go ahead and take a position tonight, only because I like the idea of Dr. Cog being a leader. We do have time. We could wait. On the other hand, signatures are being collected. And so there's no doubt, having worked on many campaigns, that the sooner the endorsements roll in, the easier it is to collect signatures, because it helps frame the issue for people. But I'm willing to defer to the body on the timing if that's important to folks. Any final comments before we vote? Director Shakti.
So I was fine with waiting a month until I heard about the number of people who won't be here. And I also won't be here. So, I mean, our alternates will all be here, but I think it will make for a different conversation.
And I would, I'll add, I'm not going to be here either. I'm not sure who's running the meeting.
Jennifer.
Because I guess it's Herb. Herb, okay.
Herb will be the only officer here.
The only, wow.
Because I won't be here either.
Just think of the havoc that can occur. Director Roth.
I hope I just enjoy your trip, because we're going to make a lot of things happen there. Myself and all the alternates.
I wanted to, yeah, you'll run the roost, huh? Mm-hmm. I just wanted to find out if there's an appetite for doing it at the work session on the 1st. That's right.
Okay, last few comments and then we're going to vote. Director Millay.
I am curious to know how many of us would have to vote, how many affirmative votes would there have to be to support this initiative?
29.
29 in the room today?
Correct.
Well,
to support or not support, we need 29. So clearly we do not have 29. So I think our decision has been made for us.
Okay. Nonetheless, we have two motions. So we will begin with the superseding motion, which would be to delay the consideration until June 15th.
Of your motion, right?
Of the prior motion, which was to support. Everybody clear on the motion before us?
Is that to the June meeting?
Yes, it was. I'm sorry. Did you want to speak to the motion? No. Okay. All in favor of the superseding motion? All opposed?
Get him a pie, please.
Right. So the motion carries 19 to 14. So we will be voting on this measure at the June 15th meeting. Do I need to vote on the other motion then?
No, I think
we'll just wait then. Okay, yes. I think it does. All right, thanks everybody for that discussion. I guess we look forward to more discussion June 15th for those of you who will be here. So we're moving on now to informational briefings, which will take us to the Fast Tracks annual status report.
Madam Chair, just before we move on, can I add one thing for Rick and the ballot? You know,
Rick and the lobby firm that are here tonight have done some yeoman's work for Dr. Cog down at the legislature this last year. And personally, I've had a chance to sit in those committee rooms with them a lot this last season, and I really like to thank all of them for the time and efforts that they put in down there for us, because they have done a great job helping us get transportation brought to the forefront. So thank all of you.
Thank you.
Thanks for those comments. Bill Van Meter, are you, or Jacob?
Jacob
Weaver. Well, they're getting a stare off, so I'm not sure which one of you wants to speak.
Mr. Van Meter, would you like me to start, or would you like to start?
We should have better coordinated this, Jacob. I'm comfortable starting.
Okay.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I am Bill Van Meter, Assistant General Manager for Planning at RTD. Many of you know me because I regularly attend these meetings as a non-voting member of the board. So appreciate the opportunity to address you with and provide our annual Fast Tracks update on as required by Dr. Cog board action from a few years ago. Just for the benefit of the few folks around the table who are relatively new to the process, and as a public service to RTD, I'll let you know that the Fast Tracks program is a transit expansion program that consists of 122 miles of new light rail and commuter rail, 18 miles of bus rapid transit, 31 new park and rides, redevelopment of Denver Union Station, and it was approved by the voters in 2004. And as I just mentioned, RTD each year provides a status report to this body on the information and progress we've made in the preceding year and where the Fast Tracks program stands at this time. So that's why I'm here, and then to answer questions at the end. To date, RTD has completed the following components of Fast Tracks: the West Quarter Light Rail Line, Denver Union Station, the Free Metro Ride, US 36 Bus Rapid Transit, that's the Flatiron Flyer, and the University of Colorado A Line, the commuter rail line from Denver Union Station to Denver International Airport. Later this year, we will be opening the following projects: the commuter rail line between Denver Union Station and Westminster, the B Line. That's the first 6 miles of the Northwest Rail Corridor. That opens on July 25th. The Gold Line, or the G Line commuter rail line, in the fall of this year from Denver Union Station through Arvada to Wheat Ridge at Ward Road. And at late this year, the I-225 light rail line. Two other Fast Tracks projects are under construction. They include the North Metro commuter rail line from Denver Union Station 124th, scheduled to open in 2018, and the Southeast Corridor extension, scheduled to open in 2019. Four Fast Tracks projects, or sections of projects, still remain to be funded. That's the Central Corridor extension from 30th and Downing to 38th and Blake, the Southwest Corridor extension from Mineral to Lucent Boulevard C-470, the Northwest Rail Line from Westminster Longmont, and the North Metro completion from 124th Avenue to State Highway 7. More details on the status of all those projects are provided in the report that was included in tonight's agenda. Just a couple few more update items for me to hit. One, it's important for me to note that RTD's board and staff are committed to finishing all of the projects that were included in the voter-approved Fast Tracks program. To that end, I do want to update you on these additional items. One, RTD staff is currently working on a study focused on the four unfunded projects that I just identified to update ridership projections, capital and operating costs, estimates, and supporting information, which will be used to prepare likely ratings for each of the projects based on the current Federal Transit Administration provisions for grant funding. So we're looking at each one of the four corridors, their cost effectiveness measures, and the other measures that the federal government uses to identify whether a corridor might be eligible for federal funding. We are planning to present this information to our board of directors in July of this year. We recently held a local governments meeting where we invited all local governments in the RTD district to come to review our ridership forecasting results and some of Dr. Cog and RTD's model and land use assumptions and the results for those four projects, a preview of some of the information that we'll be sharing with our board in July. In response to some additional questions that we've received from local staff and stakeholders, in the coming weeks we're going to hold another meeting to go into more depth on some of those same issues and some of the same land use and model projection information prior to our presentation of results to our board of directors. So one, that effort is undergoing. Are there opportunities, in a nutshell, are there opportunities for federal funding to be applied on any of the four remaining projects that are not fully funded in the Fast Tracks program? And then in two, RTD's board of directors approved the recommendations of the Northwest Area Mobility Study, commonly called NAMS, which identified options and priorities for improvements in the study area, Northwest area of RTD, substantially Boulder County and Broomfield County, recognizing that funding for completion of the Northwest Rail Corridor is not likely in the near term. So we are working on multiple recommendations that came from NAM, multiple priorities that were identified by the stakeholders and endorsed by our board of directors, including initiating our State Highway 119 Arterial Bus Rapid Transit, NEPA, that's National Environmental Policy Act, and preliminary engineering study. That will be starting later this year. That's focusing on advancing the top priority for bus rapid transit that came out of NAMS. To be clear, that is not part of the Fast Tracks program. No Fast Tracks funding is going into that. RTD has also had recent dialogue with the city councils of Longmont and Louisville to explore options to consider initial phasing options for scaled back service on the Northwest Rail Corridor. Holds the prospect of decreasing projected capital and operating costs, which could allow RTD to proceed with service sooner. We'd be looking at fewer trips, perhaps one direction, perhaps peak period only trips, things that would help us reduce the projected costs on the Northwest Rail Corridor. That, in summary, is what I had to share in terms of a snapshot update on the Fast Tracks program. I'm ready to entertain questions or comments or concerns.
I see Director Atchison had his hand up.
Bill, just a clarification on the Fast Track program cost that's contained on page 91 of the packet. That 29.2 project cost is only for the first segment of the Northwest Rail, is that correct?
That would be correct.
Do we have a current estimate, although I understand that that will change greatly based upon the time this project is projected, do we have a current estimate of the total cost of both the North Metro and Northwest Rail projects?
From the NAM study in 2013 dollars, the Northwest Rail Corridor was estimated between 1.1 and $1.4 billion for completion. That would be for the full service scenario. The completion of the North Metro was a little north of $200 million. I can't remember. 263. I appreciate support from my local stakeholder partners because I couldn't come up with that number off the top of my head.
Director Kanich.
Thank you. Bill, I'm looking at the line for the Central Extension. It says that we've spent $11.7 million through 2015. How can that be possible? That's been an unfunded corridor. I mean, I know we've spent a lot on engineering, but we could not have spent $11 million on engineering.
Yeah, so on that project, we have spent money procuring some of the light rail vehicles as well, the light rail vehicles that we would need to operate that extended service. That's what the substantial portion of those expenditures are. Some of it is on studies to date, but the substantial portion was a vehicle purchase that we made basically to complete most, if not all, of the light rail vehicle needs for the full build-out of all of the light rail commitments and fast tracks.
And is the same type of purchase the case for the other unfunded extension as well, the Southwest extension, or no, which is the unfunded, the Southwest, yeah. So did
substantially that number is substantially subsumed in the cost of vehicles. Same answer.
Well. Okay,
that is
thank
correct.
You.
Director Stolzman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Van Meter. I appreciate the update, and I appreciate you speaking with Louisville City Council. That was great. So you mentioned that there would be a follow-up meeting to the local government meeting. Do you know when that is, and is it another local government meeting, or is it a subset of attendees?
It's not another local government meeting. It is a subset of attendees. It is in the process of being scheduled. It has not been scheduled. We will be getting that information out to our stakeholders in the corridors, the Northwest Rail, North Metro, Central and Southwest Rail corridors, so that everyone has an opportunity to participate.
Thank you.
But it's not been set yet.
Great, thanks. Any other questions, comments? All right, thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Much appreciated. All right, we're moving on to committee reports. Just so I don't forget, well, never mind. I'll go ahead with and report on the stack. So the main items from the last meeting are the Transportation Commission is scheduled to adopt its update to the statewide transportation improvement program later in May. They actually held a hearing on it, and I guess it was the first time anybody's shown up to a hearing like that. I-70, Central 70, was what drew people. I guess they had about 35 people testifying for and against on that project. There's some of the legislation that did pass this legislative session was that the STAC will now report to both the Transportation Commission and to CDOT, both. Folks don't know what that looks like in terms of it's operationally, and so that's still being worked on. But that will broaden the STAC scope a little bit. CDOT did submit a Tiger grant proposal for North I-25, and a similar proposal was also submitted for that same stretch for a fast lane grant. I think CDOT is fairly confident that some funding will come through for that project one way, through one means or the other. And then lastly, STAC spent a fair amount of time noodling over lessons learned from the 2040 statewide transportation plan process so that they could further improve that. So that's the update from STAC. Director Atchison, do you want to speak about Metro Mayors?
Thank you. Metro Mayors did meet, and we probably spent 90% of our last meeting dealing with the issue of the Colorado Contractors Association proposals, so that was where it was. The Metro Mayors maintained the same position that they had previously. No one changed their position, and a unanimous vote from those present was to oppose all 10. And something took, because they withdrew all 10 today.
So you're taking full credit?
Absolutely. Every chance we get.
All right.
All 41 mayors.
All right, I'm going to pitch it for Director Rozier since he's stepped out early on the Metro Area County Commissioner's report. We actually joined forces with some of the other Front Range counties to get a briefing on the state refugee program, which was something that counties aren't directly involved with, and we wanted to learn more about the program. It was actually a very impressive presentation to hear about how the state works with the faith-based partners to actually find people homes, jobs, and provide services fairly efficiently, and that they have a fairly high rate of return on that investment in terms of the number of businesses that refugees tend to create in our community. So it was a very interesting presentation, and I think that was the sole focus of that meeting. Next up, we have, I think Director Cernanek is doing the AAA update.
Yes, I tried to be in a position.
No
where
pressure, but let's see if you can meet Jayla's.
Well, this was an exchange deal that was done with the director.
executive director so that Jayla could go home and be home with her kids so that I could give the report
in
her lieu. So I know that's obviously one of the presidential candidates negotiates better deals than I do.
kind of a low bar.
wanted to mention a couple of things. Last month had mentioned about the and I'll get the name right this time, the Accountable Healthcare Grant to CMS has been submitted from the AAA, and it will actually bring an additional $5 million if the award does come here. And again, that does bridge some of the competencies that the staff has in dealing with the Medicare grant that was earlier used, for which it wasn't extended because I think we did such a great job on that. Congratulations, Jayla, on that side. With this, the executive director mentioned, but I did want to reiterate the Boomer Bond Program and the award that it has received and the recognition that's that. And if anyone is here in any jurisdiction that hasn't looked to participate with that, if you don't use the Boomer Bond, you should be using some other assessment mechanism that determines whether you're ready or not for the demographics that are emerging. We're in the middle of them, so I don't want to mention those. And I will also mention a couple of other items. The AAA has been involved with trying to deal with affordable senior housing for those folks that can continue in independent living in two ways. One is with some of the closing down of facilities or disasters that have struck some of the facilities, trying to find them on a acute basis. I don't think I need to mention too hard to the group in this the dearth of just generally affordable housing, but particularly affordable housing for seniors is tough in the metro, very tough in the metro region. And want to applaud the staff, but also the counties that are dealing with this on an everyday basis. So that is certainly something that is out there. And as we've heard from Evan and Kirk earlier, and also in the middle of the lines of some of Bill's report on fast tracks, mobility for seniors is an important issue, and I know that a number of local jurisdictions, in conjunction with both private, nonprofit, and governmental ways, trying to close those gaps for mobility for seniors. And hopefully the members will continue to bring that to the table. And on Friday, the Advisory Committee on Aging for the AAA is meeting next door for a strategic workshop. So. I think, Jayla, you will be doing a yo person's job in facilitating and making sure we're on task for that. Okay, so Kelly will be, and so that's the report. Thank you.
Thank you. Director Shakti, the REC.
Just to give background for anybody who doesn't know about it, the region's out of compliance for ozone. The RAC is working on a state implementation plan, which is basically what we're going to do to lower the ozone levels so we're in compliance. We worked on two more chapters, and the idea is that we're going to take public comment and finalize it through the RAC, at which point it goes to the legislature next, well, it would be finalized through the RAC next month. One interesting highlight I thought was that one of the chapters is the contingency plan, and so that's if all the measures we're putting in don't work for whatever reason, what will we do? And we're already doing what we will do if it doesn't work, so we are proactive as a state.
Director Shakti, question. Over time, our air compliance issue is complicated by a significant level of transport that comes over the Continental Divide and then settles in the bowl of the Denver metro region. Other than putting some big gigantic fans to blow it a little bit further east, how does that enter into some of the calculations? Because Even if we had zero emissions in the Denver region, there's a question of whether we would be in a position to be able to meet some of the newest proposed EPA requirements.
Yeah. I would just add that the EPA is well aware of concerns about transport. I think Colorado has articulated those concerns, as have other states, and are working on guidance to those states in terms of how they address that. Director Holland?
What about the power of prayer?
Wow. All right.
Can I just make a comment? But to that point, very good point, because, yeah, the EPA, it is under consideration, but they're not doing a darn thing, frankly. So that is the reality that we are living in, and we are forced to deal with the EPA as it stands today.
All right. That was the liveliest update we've had in some time. Director Rakowski, see if you can match that for E47.
I can't. Oh. Because I'm announcing a party that Bob Roth and Steve Hogan are hosting along with the E470 board. 25 years. It starts at 10 in the morning and goes to 1400 or 2 o'clock, but you won't be there because you'll be on accelerated. So there'll be...
They're making much more of a party.
But
I got you covered, man.
There is some folks that are still agitating to replace Bob Roth on the dunk tank. On the dunk tank.
Oh.
And there's been some bylaws cleanup that have been housekeeping. And last item, I wish you could have been with me Monday night to hear our executive director, who briefed my city council, and she was priceless.
And we got press today in the Villager.
Well, that's because I told them that I would stop my subscriptions if they didn't cover you.
And he might be the only paid subscription.
Yeah.
Hell, I might even write a column about it next week.
Yeah. Jeez, who knew? All right. That was great. That was great. Anybody that's announcing parties, Bill, do you have more to add on fast tracks?
Nothing more to add.
All right. I want to draw everyone's attention to item number 16 in the informational items, which is a new item that's going to be added to our packet in the future. I'm told by Doug Rex it's the TIP administrative modifications. I have no idea what it means, but I'm sure it's really exciting.
Like us to explain it?
Yes, please.
There are, according to your TIP policy, there are some changes to the TIP that staff can make without bringing them to the board, but we felt like the best thing to do was, even though we can do that, it would be a good idea to make sure that you saw those when we did do them. So that's what that is in there. Anything else?
We appreciate the transparency. So thanks for doing that, and sorry for my glib comments. We do appreciate that. So any other final announcements? Oops, we have two. I see Director Partridge and then Director Graves.
Madam Chair, since you're doing so well on time, maybe a little levity. You know, when one of our directors wears an accessory or maybe a functional piece of clothing that may be worth noting, I think we should take note of that. And you're probably wondering where I'm going this, but Director Cernanik, I see one of your men's hosiery. I wonder if they both match, and maybe you would share those with us.
Wow. Oh, wait. We have a sock off. Are there any other fashion statements that we want to draw attention to? Yes. Well, you can't stop them sometimes. All right, Director Graves.
I just love that Director Partridge said men's hosiery out loud,
yeah.
Actually. That was really great. With that,
A more somber note, apparently. I just wanted to thank all present who participated in the IBM Smarter Cities Challenge interviews to really look at how we might leverage technology solutions around how we serve the homeless as a region. And I want to remind you about the next steps. So IBM will now issue us a detailed report in about a month's time. They presented the executive summary to the public. Many of you were there. Once we get the detailed report, the City of Denver, the Metro Mayor's Caucus, will be convening a small committee to review that report and ultimately determine what the feasibility is of implementing it and assessing the fiscal note and where we might source money to go after those technologies to share data and better serve these vulnerable populations. So I just want to give you a quick update there, and thank you again for your participation. Thank you.
Thank you. Jennifer.
And I'd just like to thank all the board members who have participated with Cone to help us put together a new onboarding program. I know that some members were interviewed about how the process has worked up to this point. There were some members tonight, actually, that were taped that will be part of the new program as well. So I just want to thank you for taking that extra time and helping us make this new program be a real success.
Great. Director Holland.
I just want to thank Mayor Serrani publicly and those for his, number one, his fashion statement, but also the fact that the City of Littleton did help the county in providing some funding for the individual elderly seniors who were displaced by the fire. We still have 60 individuals who do not have permanent housing, so it's trails into some of the issues that are raised about the AAA and the lack of adequate housing for our elderly. So we've been pleading with a variety of organizations and individual apartment owners to see if we can find permanent housing for these people. So it's just a classic example of what we're facing in the next 10 to 20 years. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I think we're done here. Thank you, everybody. We are adjourned.